Rediscover Aesthetics is all about making you look and feel your best. So combined with our three practitioners here, I'm a physician assistant of 15 years. We have a nurse practitioner and a registered nurse who are all ready and capable of handling all of your facial aesthetic needs, but as well as your medical wellness needs, such as medical weight loss, IV nutrition, even hormone replacement therapy.
I've been working, part of my ministry is the working with the homeless and addicts, and I work with a lot of them here in the community, and for the last 15 years, I've had that opportunity. A lot I do is I feed the homeless under the bridges in New Orleans, and out of that, I've had the opportunity to meet different people. If you've never had the opportunity to sit with a homeless person and just talk to them, you know, we tend to, if you don't do that, you stereotype the homeless person. A lot of us are one paycheck away, or one tragedy, or one unfortunate circumstance away from being homeless. So I just ask that you open your hearts and just listen. And we respect your questions and your concerns, and we hope to answer those and meet those. I want to share with you something. A friend of mine, when I told her about this meeting, she found something. I don't do social media, but she does. And she found this on there. It's a testimony of someone, of a lady. So she printed it out for me. And I just want to share this with y'all. It's called Something to Think About. What if you were a single parent with a child, you work full time for $14 an hour, and you bring home roughly $800 per paycheck every 2 weeks? Your bills are $1,000 rent, $150 electricity, $250 car payment, $150 car insurance. So let's do the math. You bring home roughly about $1,600 a month, and your bills average about $1,550, give or take. You're making it, but barely. This does not even include groceries, internet, cable, cell phone, etc., nor does it include child tax credit or child support. Now, it's a really cold December, and you get an electric bill for $600, so how do you pay it? To put it simply, you do not, because you can't. So your power gets turned off, but you know what your lease says. It says that you get evicted if your utilities are terminated. So now you're in court crying to a judge who doesn't care, and you have 10 days to get out of your home. Well, you're in luck because you found somewhere with 3 days to spare, and it is only $650 a month. But to get in, you must pass a background and credit checks, which you cannot because you were just evicted. You have never been a criminal, but even if you could pass them, you're looking at $1,300 to move in after paying deposit and first month's rent, not including utilities to be turned on. Time's up, the landlord shows up at 7 in the morning with the police and changes your locks. So now you're living in your car with your 7-year-old son and everything you need to get by. You tried to get a storage unit, but you do not have a billing address, so they will not rent you one. So you could only take what would fit in your back seat. You pay to shower at local truck stops and eat whatever can be cooked in a gas station microwave. Someone sees you and your son living like this and calls Child Protective Services. Guess what happens next? They remove your child from your care. As if this is not devastating enough, you lose your job because an employee losing their child reflects poorly on this company. So now, you apply for an apartment with the region where the waiting list is 3 to 7 years. Then you go to Walmart to put in an application. When you get back to your car, you see that your back window has been smashed and someone helped themselves to your belongings. Remember that it is December and really cold. Now you have damage to your only shelter. You call your car insurance, who says your deductible is $1,000 and they are going to increase your monthly rate now since you are high risk. You call the homeless shelter as a last resort and all their beds are full. I will stop here because I think you get the point. The people we work with every day are these people. We are these people. We are all so close to homelessness and do not even realize it. All it takes is one unexpected bill, one bad medical report, one fender bender, a layoff, a house fire, etc. Instead of talking trash about people who are poor, homeless, or need assistance, why try being grateful that you are not in their shoes yet? This is about staying humble and being kind. Be thankful for what you have. We are all struggling in different ways. This was a true story that she had found of a lady. But I know personally, I have met people under the bridges in New Orleans. Most recently, I've met some older people, women just like me, or older, that because their husbands took care of them all their lives and they had no other family, they were out under the streets because they had no way to pay their rent. They didn't know how to work. They had no skills. So it's just, it's a problem. And hopefully we can find the answers to that with the Lord's help He's provided.
So this is the Cornerstone project. We're in the beginning planning phases of this project. We actually operated non-congregate emergency shelter at this location from April of 2020 through January of 2021. We did not have any major issues. We didn't have an increase in crime. We had no major issues. We had case management staff on site daily. We also operated at in Ponchatoula from January of 2022 through May of 2022, non-congregate shelter partnering with motels. The difference between what we do at non-congregate shelter versus what happens after a disaster in Hurricane Ida is that there's on-site security and that there's supportive services via case management. So Carolyn Jackson on our staff as well as interns from Southeastern, the second go-round of non-congregate shelter, assisted in the daily staffing to ensure that people were safe and that people moved into permanent housing from the emergency shelter projects that we operated. So our plans are, for the renovated portion of the building, which we're in now, they have 56 rooms. Half of those are double beds. Half of those are rooms with single beds. And so this model would allow us to serve both individuals and families. And so 60% of the persons that are entering into our coordinated entry system are families with children. For phase two in yellow, we'd like to create efficiency apartments with kitchenettes. We included some information in your informational packets that in order for rent to be affordable for single adults on SSI, it would have to be subsidized at about $235 per month. We are seeing older adults entering into our coordinated entry system. We get daily reports from Tangipahoa Parish Section 8 office of people living in uninhabitable living situations with mold, with rat infestations, literally falling apart. The third phase is a client and services activity center or a community hub. With office space and space for a clinic, we would like to partner with community organizations to provide legal assistance, case management, behavioral health, therapy, counseling, workforce development. We really feel that this is there is a needed place. Like we saw the recent article in WDSU about the freeze nights and folks not knowing where to go because there is not a centralized location that's publicized where people can access much needed services. We do have $6.8 million awarded for this project from the Office of Community Development, the Louisiana Housing Corporation, and the Federal Home Loan Bank of Dallas Affordable Housing Program, and we are applying for additional funds. Next slide. This is the property survey that we completed throughout the purchasing process. We were notified that the front of the building was actually not a part of this property. So we had a survey completed. And what I've highlighted is this Nuccio Lane, which according to our land survey is a public access right of way. So I just wanted to make that clear regarding what our plans were and the due diligence that we've completed was that we had access to a public right of way for this building. Next slide. Another concern that's been brought up is a parking plan. We are working with Tom Pistorius of Pistorius Associates. We've completed preliminary parking plans to ensure that there is sufficient parking for the uses of this building. Next slide. For our project partners, the Northlake Homeless Coalition is serving as the lead agency. Gulf Coast Housing Partnership, we have entered into a project management agreement with them for construction and development project management. As I just noted, Tom with Pistorius Associates has been selected as the architect for the project. And you may be familiar with VLink, who operates 211. They also operate our homeless management information system and are actively involved and committed to ensuring that we have appropriate data and resources for the project on the data side. And then we just kind of wanted to get into a few things that we've heard regarding the project and regarding homeless shelters in general. The first is that the Northlake Homeless Coalition is an outside organization that does not care about the community. The organization was actually created by a group of agencies over 20 years ago throughout the Florida Parishes region, including Dr. Bonnie Lewis with Southeastern University's Data Center. We have an office in Tangipahoa Parish, and our board president, Tony Jackson, has a long history of housing and disaster recovery work in the parish. We are actively working to identify additional community partners specifically within this parish for this project. The second myth is that this project will not serve residents of the community. We have a snapshot of homelessness that is current as of last week based on all of the folks that we assess, and we know that we don't have the capacity to assess everybody and that we aren't aware of everybody. But there are currently 52 households on our prioritization list who are homeless or at imminent risk of homelessness in Tangipahoa Parish. 60% of those are families with children. The third is that the project will increase crime in the surrounding area. As I noted, we operated a shelter at this location from April of 2020 through January of 2021 without any major safety concerns or increases in crime. We are in the process of installing a security system with cameras while the building is vacant. Our plan is to have 24/7 security on site to ensure that the project is safe and effective for all. That was not the case when this operated as a motel. There was no security on site when it operated as a motel. Next slide. Shelters can help reduce crime in communities by providing a safe and supportive environment for individuals who might otherwise engage in criminal activity to survive. Again, plans for this project include security and on-site case management services. Secondly, this program model differs from a traditional shelter model in which persons are required to leave the facility during the day. We know that there are concerns about people loitering outside. The program is designed so that clients will be directed to the courtyard, which is behind our building, and will be staffed to ensure that clients are not loitering outside of the building. We have plans to fence the property with staff ensuring that clients remain inside the property and do not create a nuisance to neighbors. The goal of this project is to serve as a hub for community engagement and outreach. We are actively seeking to collaborate with volunteers, faith-based and community organizations to provide holistic services and resources to those in need. I would say that the project would not exclude people from within the Florida Parishes region. However, I've been doing this work for 16 years and people don't want to leave their home communities. And you can talk to any organization that you know of, and I'm talking about our domestic violence agencies, even in the cases of domestic violence, the survivors do not want to leave their communities. So we don't anticipate, and in our experience in operating, we have not had people who are really wanting to leave their home community for a shelter in another community. There are shelters in St. Tammany Parish. Yeah. There are several.
There's more than one in St. Tammany. But the thing is, whenever someone calls and needing some place to stay, then we tell them that we might be able to find a place in Baton Rouge or New Orleans. They do not want to go. We tell them that we might be able to find something in St. Tammany Parish. They don't want to go. So, if they live here, they want to stay here. They don't want to go anywhere else outside of the parish. really outside. If they live in Hammond, if this is where they've been, they don't want to go outside of Hammond. So I don't know if it's transportation. I don't know what, you know, why, but they generally, you know, they are from here, been here, and want to stay here. They don't want to go anywhere else, even when we offer.
Well, again, we're still in the planning stages specifically for this, but as long as there is room availability and somebody wants to bring somebody to the facility and they're willing to come in and abide by the regulations. And so we don't want to create a whole ton of barriers, but I can tell you, because this will be a facility that would serve both individuals and children, sex offenders wouldn't be allowed. It just would not, it would be a safety concern. No weapons, no drugs, no alcohol, because we want this program to be accessible for everybody, but we also want it to be safe for everybody. So we would like to actively work with law enforcement as they identify people who want to come in. As long as there's space available, we would be able to accept them. And I don't think that that's the case right now. We got a call from Tangipahoa Parish Government yesterday that there were two people that were still in the warming shelter and they had nowhere to bring them.
I'm Carrie Benitez inside the heart of Franco's Gym at Rediscover Aesthetics with Arden. Now, Arden, I'm going to go ahead and give you an opportunity to tell our audience about some of your experience and what is Rediscover.
Rediscover Aesthetics is all about making you look and feel your best. So combined with our three practitioners here, I'm a physician assistant of 15 years. We have a nurse practitioner and a registered nurse who are all ready and capable of handling all of your facial aesthetic needs, but as well as your medical wellness needs, such as medical weight loss, IV nutrition, even hormone replacement therapy. The newest wellness craze is probably something very familiar to your audience already. We're adding IV nutrition services to Rediscover Aesthetics here at Franco's, where you can come in and get an assessment by some of our qualified practitioners. You can even put your kids in childcare while you get your IV nutrition. I don't know anybody else who can do that, but we have several offerings to help either help you gain focus or lose weight, or even just help you out after one of those long nights watching the LSU game.
Be sure to tell our audience that this is not a trend. This is something here to stay. IVs are the newest way to go.
Absolutely. IV nutrition has so many benefits for your health and wellness, whether in the short term or even long term effects, where there's so many different offerings that we can choose from to help you achieve the fitness and wellness goals that you're looking to achieve.
I know in my personal life, I've heard a lot of people that said they were going to doctors, they couldn't figure out what was wrong, they started doing IV, and for them personally, it changed their life.
80% of our community is chronically dehydrated, so even just adding additional fluids in that way helps you lose weight, helps you stay fuller longer, helps your focus and your cognition. There's many health benefits to them.
Let's talk about some of your current services that are in effect. You bring up weight loss. Tell us a little bit about your medical weight loss program.
So medical weight loss is the topic of so many trends and even controversy right now. We offer semaglutide to our patients, which is the medical weight loss craze of the year. And I think it's a phenomenal drug when it's done correctly. And in our practice, we make sure to hold our patients' hand and keep them accountable, and also focus on their mindset so that one day they can get off the medicine and keep the weight off.
Something so special about Rediscover compared to other aesthetic companies is your dynamic partnership behind the scenes. Tell us a little bit about your coworkers.
There's no way that I could run this business without the females in my life. My wife is a registered nurse, and she and I started this practice about 3.5 years ago. And we just hired a nurse practitioner who is outstanding. Her name is Amber. And together, they kind of keep me in line. I'm the one that does the interviews, and they're the one that keeps the business running.
I hear that you have your own special niche and your wife takes over the other half. Tell us a little bit about how that partnership works.
Right. So I'm primarily responsible for our facial injectables in the clinic. So when we do dermal fillers or biostimulants, PDO threads is another specialty that we have. I'm the one that's doing those. My wife runs our laser, does our chemical peels, and she's also a skincare expert.
To those people at home that are hearing about all these things that aren't too familiar about it, how can they find out more information?
The best thing to do is schedule a free consultation. They can call or text us, 985-322-3005. We'll give them a free consultation right here in the office.
Anything else you'd like to tell our audience?
I think that our clinic is separated from others in that we're inside a health club. So you get a day pass here, you can use the sauna, you can drop your kids off in childcare and get a workout in while you're getting your medical consultation.